In this painting's companion piece, we can also see human figures of minuscule proportion. This is Abbey in the Oak Woods, one of the best known of all Friedrich's paintings. Here, we can identify a funeral procession taking place outside the ruins of a Gothic abbey. This is a compelling image, but it would be hard to describe this as an image of beauty. Instead, Friedrich conveys a sense of something far more subtle, the sublime.
The notion of the sublime was really set against the beautiful in the 18th century. It's an aesthetic concept. The sublime described everything that was awe-inspiring, horrific, grand. I sometimes equate it to the sort of notions developed in modern horror movies, anything that really grabs you. And, of course, Burke developed this in a kind of theoretical treatise.
In Germany, there was a bit of a problem with this way of looking at the sublime as being what I might call a purely physical response. In Germany, with the interest in metaphysics, they saw it more in spiritual terms. And I think it's very significant that the philosopher Immanuel Kant, when he talks about the sublime, talks about the sublime in terms of spiritual elation. He talks about it as being overpowering, but not necessarily as frightening. And one of the images he gives to suggest this is the image of the night sky. He says, you look at the night sky, you see these wonderful galaxies, and they are beyond our imagination, but they don't frighten us. They fill us with admiration and awe and wonder. And I think that kind of sublime, the sublime of something that is infinite, that goes beyond us, but is not necessarily frightening, can be inspiring, is something that was much more appealing to Friedrich. I think Friedrich is more closely associated with that kind of sublime that you find in Kant than the kind of horror sublime than you find in Burke.
The Abbey in the Oak Woods remains a triumph of romantic landscape painting. He was now a successful and well-known figure, though this self-portrait of the time hardly suggests a man content with his fortunes. Ultimately, material gain was not Friedrich's ambition. The evolution of his art was his goal. In the summer of 1810, Friedrich left Dresden with a fellow artist and friend, Georg Kersting. Their destination was the Riesengebirge Mountains to the south of his home city. That summer, the two men sketched the harsh landscape of the region. Back in his Dresden studio, Friedrich's sketches inspired oil paintings like this sublime mountain scene, where we again see the dramatic symbol of the isolated crucifixion. As before, we might choose to see this as a symbol of Germany itself. Perhaps the most famous of all Friedrich's works depicts a human figure with his back to the viewer. Completed in 1818, the same year as the artist's marriage, this is Wanderer Watching a Sea of Fog. There is much to consider in the painting.
Wanderer Watching a Sea of Fog is one of the most striking of his pictures, which have figures viewed to the back. But there's also a funny way in which the landscape almost seems to buckle under his gaze. You can sort of see the way that it's almost caving in on one side or another, as though the concentration of the thought is almost overcoming the landscape. So it has this curious image of what you might call loneliness and empowerment at the same time. This is somebody's vision which is inspiring but also isolating, and perhaps that kind of curious romantic image of the person who is in one sense tremendously excited but is also tremendously isolated is brought out in this picture.
It uses the motif of the figure seen from behind to greatest effect. It has this man standing at the very centre of the composition. Very large, it fills the picture space. Immediately we begin to ask questions. What is he doing there? Why is he standing on top of a mountain? The mountains this man is presumably looking at are all covered in fog, so we can't even see what he's looking at. We're then confronted with another void, another level of questions. That means that Friedrich opens up the whole business of painting. for us to think about our role, about the painter's role, about the subject's role.
Friedrich's landscapes are idealized scenes. The great gorge depicted in the chalk cliffs of Rügen has never been located on the island. Images like this are the product of the artist's personal vision, the vision of the soul. The most famous quote of Friedrich's career relates to this. He advised young painters that they should close their bodily eye so that they could see with their spiritual eye.
Friedrich was very concerned that art was about the inner vision, about what you felt, about what you yourself had thought. And he was very worried by the fact that so much of what people were taught in academies was that art was just about what everyone sees. It's about the regular, it's having to adopt somebody else's ideas, having to learn what other people have done. And he took the opposite view. He was always saying to young artists, no, look inside yourself. Paint what comes from your inner being. That's the most important thing. That's much more important than anything you can learn in the academy. And I think this is why he kept on emphasizing this in his remarks.
For the actual painting process, he felt he had to shut himself away from anything that could disturb his inner vision. This reliance on inner vision is essential to his art. We know from paintings by a colleague of his showing Friedrich in his studio that the studio too was completely bare. Friedrich had nothing, absolutely nothing, except his easel. And even the shutters on his windows, we can see from these paintings, are closed, so he couldn't look out. We even have stories about him painting in the nude to get this completeness of the self.
As an artist, Friedrich put his visionary ideas into practice. Though he sketched widely, his completed paintings were idealized images, the product of his inner eye.